if I want to grow cannabis in Florida, what's my first steps in to do that?
Your first steps, procure a warehouse, I would say. You're going to need to grow it indoors, most likely.
Right, so we're not growing outside in Florida?
No, you cannot. The moisture content of the air is too high.
Anybody else have any input on if you want to start growing cannabis in Florida, you know, are there any special protocols to take? You know, Aaron says we need to grow inside, right, because the humidity is too high. I know some people are, you know, think that, you know, outdoor is everything, but, you know, we have a lot of humidity problems here. But I think that one of the things that we hear a lot of is a lot of farmers that want to start to grow cannabis, you know, to change their crop, you know.
Right.
How easy is that for them to do that?
Cannabis, a lot of people have the misconception that cannabis can be grown like any fruit or vegetable. For instance, strawberries or tomatoes, as we see here in Florida. But in reality, it really is more like growing cut flowers, and it's a very delicate flower at that. So they would have to pretty much change just about everything about what they know about growing unless they're already growing something like cut flowers. It's going to be a lot more problematic for them, especially considering mold is a prevalent problem. If you're giving this as medicine to people that are immunocompromised, then what you're doing is you're giving them lots of mold that could, in effect, do harm or even kill them. So it's not a good idea to take any risk where that's involved. So.
If you're not looking to open a grow or to grow cannabis in the state of Florida, what other kinds of businesses are available in the cannabis industry other than cultivation? I'll pose that question to the whole panel.
Well, there would be dispensary, of course, you know, having a dispensary. That would be another, you know, something to do with cannabis. And then the way that that's set up is usually the way that I set up dispensaries are in regards to Section 280E, which we'll go into later. I have a presentation about it, but typically that's what you do with dispensaries, is you set them up in such a way that you're avoiding the repressive 280E. That's typically how dispensaries are. Now, growers don't fall under that because the way that they can deduct things are different than an actual dispensary. So the way that you would set up a dispensary versus a grower would be two completely different things. You would set up either a corporation or an LLC, or two corporations and two LLCs is typically what you would do.
Okay, it's different for a cultivator than it would be for someone that's actually selling.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. And that would be, you know, the different advice that I would give. You know, if somebody's going to grow, they can deduct things that a dispensary can't. So it's a little bit different in the way that you set up. So I set up everything looking at it through the eyes of tax. Mm-hmm. And obviously on my team, I have an attorney that, you know, will look at it. Well, you know, legally, can we do it this way, that way, or the other way? So that's typically what I do.
So we hear a lot about 280E, and we hear a lot about marijuana businesses having a lot of cash on hand.
Yes.
And a lot of assets in on their property. So what can, you know, marijuana businesses do to protect that?
As a matter of fact, we found a banking solution. So I've been in cannabis for about 5 years now. I have a federal license, so I can operate in all 50 states. So what I've done is I've tried to find partners that can work with us. So we have a partner that can set up a local bank at an actual bank with merchant services, with the ability to get loans, with the ability to do all of that. And they act as a middleman, and they'll find a local bank for you. So it's not like it was, and this is brand new as of January, it's not like it was a few years ago where everything was cash, or you would recommend Bitcoin or something like that. So you don't have to have all that cash in your dispensary anymore.
Gotcha. Tony, any thoughts on?
So I agree that it's not like it was 4 or 5 years ago when we started looking at security strategies. And if you really look at the cannabis industry, you have to kind of equate it to other high-risk businesses, and keeping in mind that you're selling a product that has it's very desirable, and you have a large amount of cash. So if you look at your industry and you look at it and you take that highly desirable item and you substitute it for jewelry or gold or firearms or tobacco or lottery tickets, and you look at how they manage those businesses, it's very similar in a dispensary how you would manage your dispensary. Now, when you look at a grow facility, you have to look at it and equate that to, say, like a jewelry processing center or somewhere else. There's a large amount of a product in one area that you would want to secure. So, again, that goes back to, you know, how do you protect your cash? It's not a unique thing in this industry. You just have to learn from how other industries protect the cash. And then the question you posed about, are there other businesses? You know, when you look at cannabis and you look at the product itself, it kind of equates it of being back in the old days when you were people would go and pan for gold up in the hills, and they go up in the hill and they go and pan and they come back with the gold into town. Well, the gold miners really weren't the ones that made the money. It was the ancillary businesses, the guy that sold the picks, the shovels, the horses. So there's a lot of the cannabis business that doesn't actually touch the plant if you wanted to get involved in this industry and not be involved directly in the plant. I'm a pick and shovel salesperson, basically. I sell security. There's a tax group. There's people who do video surveillance for companies. There's armored car services. There's guard agencies. And that's just in the security field. There are people that sell the water, the dirt, the pesticides, or whatever else you need to grow it. So when you're looking at this industry, it's not only being a grower or a dispensary, but there are a lot more ancillary businesses out there than you would than you might think.
So what would you say goes into that choice when you're deciding, are you going to go into the infused products or touching the plant kind of business or an ancillary business? What are the risks and the rewards for both? You want to?
And that's perfect.
You've made that decision, Jill.
That is perfect for you.
Well, it is definitely much more risky to touch the plant. There's no doubt about it. I mean, you have to be very agile in the decisions you make and being able to change because the laws change. In California, we haven't had a lot of guidelines other than, you know, standard basic proposition that allowed for medical marijuana. So along the way, we've had to make up our own rules in a very self-policing way. It depends where your passion is. I mean, I believe we're all very passionate about cannabis being here. For me, building the brand, I wanted to touch the plant. I wanted to create a different form of consumption other than smoking. And that was my motivation, and still is very much my passion.
So you had that vision. One day you decided you wanted to do this. What was the first thing? What was the jumping in point? What did you do first to start that empire you now call House of Pain?
I put a blindfold on and I just literally jumped off a cliff. Yeah. I had been very familiar with cannabis over the years, having grown it at an early age, and I was inspired really by the coffee houses of Amsterdam, and thinking why won't there be a beverage? Why couldn't there be a beverage instead of smoking weed? And really that's how I got started. I knew nothing about the industry in reality, but it was something that I was just so passionate about that it's almost like if you just put yourself out there and you just have the energy, things start coming to you and making it happen.
So now that you're starting your cannabis business and you have your plan and you have your dream, you have your vision, you need some money. Right. You need some capital. You need somebody to help push you along. So what are the kind of the first steps in trying to find some financing to, you know, to make this company happen?
Well, I think at first it's important to be able to have proof of concept and being able to bootstrap it to the standpoint of being able to be able to share your vision in a way that makes sense. I mean, you could put something up on a cocktail napkin, but if you can actually have something that's, you know, in your hand, something tangible that you've proven works, that's the first step, be it how primitive it might be, right? And I think it's about passion. I think when people really see that you have a vision and that your concept is viable, that will attract money. But you know, you've got to be able to show the roadmap of getting from here to there, and in this industry, people understand that roadmap is going to take a lot of zigzags along the way. It's not just a straight trajectory by any means.
It's not. You're 100% correct.
Anyone else?
Yeah, I mean, I would just like to add, I mean, Joe mentioned why not produce a beverage that could do the same thing. It's interesting because I feel that there's a lot of innovation left to be done in terms of process. And one of the problems I see in Florida is that we have all these bills proposed for vertical integration, and I think that stifles all this innovation that could be happening, because what you're doing is you're telling one person to fill every role. And in doing so, you're kind of pushing people out that might come up with new creative ways of processing the material. One of the most recent innovations I think is fantastic is somebody out in California, I can't remember his name at the time right now, but somebody out in California came up with this idea of pressing the trichomes to produce what's called rosin. And it's a solventless concentrate. You can inhale it, it doesn't do the same damage that smoking does, but also it doesn't have any solvents in it. And this was just a very simple but brilliant idea, because there is all these problems with concentrates and extracts having solvents in them, even things using extracts performed using critical CO2. You would think there would be no solvents in that, but there still are, because you're involving carbon. But just pressing it, that was a wonderful, simple innovation that somebody came up with, and there needs to be more of that. And so that's why, you know, I think people should stick with what they know. You know, if you're a cultivator, you know, stick with plants. If you're a good salesperson, good marketer, stick with dispensing and ancillary businesses. If you're a chemist or something of that nature, you know, stick with processing. But there needs to be people need to be allowed to specialize, and I think it's important that, you know, in these upcoming or with the current legislative session and I guess subsequent legislative sessions, you know, we really push for specialization and the awarding of more licenses and just specialized licenses. I just wanted to mention that.
Yeah, and that's kind of a problem is right now, I mean, this is still being legislated, right? So we don't know what this is going to look like, right? So a perfect example of that is that last week I talked to a dispensary in Nevada, right? And in Nevada, if you're a dispensary, that's all you can do is be a dispensary. You can't have any other business like a caregiving or something like that that goes with the dispensary. That's the only state out of the 28 states where it's legal where that actually happened. So we don't know what Florida's actually gonna do with the legislation. And I think we're all sort of waiting on all of that. And then of course, they'll change it, they'll, you know, do different things. And I know right now that we have, you know, the 7 license holders and the low THC, and I know we have that currently, but I think Amendment 2 was clear that we wanted to expand that. And I think that the legislature is having a hard time in expanding it.
So, go ahead.
I was gonna say, I think that exactly what we've been saying about specializing and diversifying, You know, a lot of times I'll speak at these events and I speak across the United States, and people come and say, I want to grow, and then they realize for whatever reason they can't grow, or I want to be a dispensary and they realize they can't, and they kind of give up on their dream, not really thinking a little bit more out of the box. And whether you are a person who's directly involved with the plant or an ancillary person, you know, you need to look at all those factors. You know, somebody sold me these socks. You know, somebody sells vapor, somebody sells the widget that helps in the cannabis industry. So don't give up if the grow doesn't work for you in Florida or wherever you are, a dispensary, and maybe think about how you support the industry in another way. Are you the person who makes the best chocolate in the world that someone's going to infuse if there's an infusion in the state that you're in? Or are you going to do something else? The perfect example is there's a dispensary up in Seattle that I love. Uncle Ike's is the name of the dispensary. They have a dispensary, and in the parking lot, they have another building where they sell all of their shirts and pipes and all those other things, separate from the dispensary. The shirts and pipes makes more money than the dispensary. So, you know, give that some thought about when you're going to be growing or when you're going to be entering this industry, that if grow doesn't work for you and the plant doesn't, is there something else that might fit for you to enter this arena?
That's a very good point. Very good point.
Really, really good point there, Tony. It's and the thing is that people need to, you know, tap into their talents and what drives them. I talk to a lot of people that want to start dispensaries and want to start grows, and once they realize what's involved in farming and what's involved in running a retail operation, that it's just like running a retail operation. It kind of loses a little bit of its luster, but they have a passion for something else. And when they find that, that's when you see these businesses explode. One of my favorites is a company called Green Brothers. Green Bros out of, I think they're out of California, I think. They just came up with a trimming system. And we watched them kind of evolve this trimming system to help grows trim their, you know, buds more efficiently. And the two guys just out of the Navy 3 years ago, they had a concept, and now they are producing this machinery and distributing it to all these grows around the country. And it's just a really kind of inspiring story about guys that actually found a niche and really like capitalized on it. So it's one of my favorite stories. One of the things I did want to ask that's really on a lot of people's minds, and I know I get this question a lot, is there isn't legislation, there's stuff up in the air, what can I do, or what do I do, how can I create a plan that can be changed on the fly when a law changes? What do I do, how do I plan for that, what's my contingency?
I think right now you wait, you just be patient and wait, because we could do something where we could set something up, and then the legislature says, no, you can't do that. So I think it's something where we just have to be patient and wait and see what the legislature says. And I know that they're working on it. I know that there's special sessions that are going on, but I think it's something where it's just, you know, and I hate being patient. I'm not the most patient person in the world, but be patient, because what you can do is you can spend a lot of money setting something up in a certain way, and then Florida says, well, wait a minute, you can't do that. Mm-hmm. So it's something that I think that you have to be patient and wait.
I think I do agree that you're gonna have to wait and see how your state evolves, and if we're talking Florida, but I do think that there's a lot of times you wanna make sure you're planning things. I'll give you, we help with people getting applications across the United States. The state of Texas, in their wisdom, came out on March 1st with their application, which is due March 30th. If you decided on March 1st you want to get into this industry, you're not. It's not happening. State of Pennsylvania was due on March 20th. So you do have to start thinking about what your strategy is going to be and be nimble enough to move around. But if you think that one of his applications coming out somewhere in June or July here, if you haven't started, you're behind the curve, because people have already started.
That's a very good point, yes, very good point.
Great, well, I think we have some questions from the audience, so we will start taking those.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for all your information. So in Florida especially, we have users and patients that are not really familiar with all of the modalities, methods of ingestion. So for those of us that are familiar and travel around especially, you know, we tend to speak in certain terms, but when I'm consulting with patients here, they have no idea what that is. So in addition to your marketing for your businesses, do you do community education and community outreach, and is that part of your marketing?
I think that's something that's a little out of my realm, but I think it's something where you're doing the re-education process, right? So you're in a new business and you're doing the re-education process. Some people know a little bit about cannabis and its medicinal quality. So I think it's more of a, you know, you have to do your own, you have to do it yourself, basically, because nobody else is doing it.
I think the value of these events, this one today,
exactly,
is the education of it. People come to these events, they know very little about the plant or what it can do, and whether it's CBD or THC or any of those other letters that are out there, you know, you begin to start understanding what the value of that plant is. I really think that there's an ancillary business out there that could just educate people on the value of what that plant can do for you. And I think that that's something that could be explored.
I agree with that 100%. From a marketing standpoint, you know, marketing and education are very, 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 very similar. That's why we don't like marketing in schools, right? Because it blurs the line, right? So when you're marketing your company, you want to be educated. You want to be reaching out to the community. You want to be that source, right? You want people to come to you for that. And that, you know, also in this industry helps the community. I'll take the next question from the crowd.
Hi, my name's Tanya. I'm from Wellborn in Sarasota, Florida. I have two questions. The first one is, I'd like to understand a little bit more on the moisture challenge of growing cannabis outdoors, and does that affect all strains, including CBD, hemp, and THC in marijuana?
Okay, so, you know, cannabis will grow just about anywhere. Here's the problem, though. Cannabis doesn't care if it gets a mold infestation or whatever. It'll still produce seeds and it'll still pass on its genetics for the next season. What we care about, however, is creating, you know, getting a mold-free cannabis. So the state of Florida has an unusually high, you'll see in my talk later, but the state of Florida has a really high, what we call dew point or wet bulb temperature on average throughout the year. This is an indirect measure of the amount of moisture that's in the environment. So people, there's a misconception that you want to consider relative humidity. Well, if you compare relative humidity in Florida to relative humidity, say, in Washington, you might find that throughout the year, the relative humidity will be about the same in both places. But that's misleading, because for the same relative humidity, Florida has twice the moisture content in the air, because the warmer air will hold more moisture than does Washington. So the thing is, when you have that much moisture available, you have two problems. One, if you try to do a greenhouse, you're going to have to work really hard to get that extra moisture out of the air to bring the relative humidity down. So that's a huge energy expense. Two, probably not going to have the equipment to do it. But two, if you're doing it outdoors, that available moisture, that's just going to help mold spores, I guess, start growing all the more, because what's going to happen is as the plant grows, you might get a mold spore that ends up embedded in the bud, and then the cola grows around that. Well, the relative humidity right next to the plant where the water is, from which the water is transpiring through the leaves, that's going to be a little bit higher, and that's going to give that mold spore a little extra kick. So then what you're going to end up with, you know, you may not even notice it. But you will, if you use fluorescence and you look at the plant, you might notice that the plant itself is covered in mold, even though if it doesn't appear to be so. So, I mean, there's mold-resistant strains out there. There are strains, you know, certain sativa lines, such as hemp, that grow very sparse. However, that still won't prevent the mold issue. You're still going to end up with mold. There are, for instance, CBN and CBG, those two substances are antifungal, but Florida is prevalent with mold, and it's one of the few places in the United States that's actually like that. So,
thank you. My second question is, can you define solvents and why you don't want them in your extract?
Oh, sure. So basically, solvents are anything that will dissolve something else. So typically what we use is in the industry, what's used are, you know, you might use ethanol, which is a safe solvent, fairly safe, because it's, you know, alcohol that we drink. Methanol is another one, propane, butane, even in critical CO2, benzene forms. Now, these solvents are dangerous because what they essentially do, they get into your bloodstream, kind of thins your blood out, but it's also, it acts on the neurons in the sense that, you know, it'll actually start dissolving cell membranes. So you kind of don't want this, especially you don't want to be inhaling these type of things. When you inhale solvents, it doesn't give your liver the ability to process them. So it just goes right into the bloodstream and does even more damage.
Good questions.
Hi, my name is Angela. I'm looking to start, I have started a company actually, Mindful Medicinals. And my question is, in Florida right now, being that it's the seven that hold these rights or availabilities, do I, as this new business owner, do I search them out to try to ask them to have my product in their dispensaries? Or can I kind of go online and do my own thing without them in Florida right now? Does that make sense? Say if I wanted to do one-to-one, you know, eventually, can I just do that on my own, or do I need to align with someone with a license?
Well, you would need a license, right?
I mean, in California, as we're progressing now to Prop 64 and rec, and we've had just this we've been in the dark ages in some ways, but in every state, it's going to go the direction where you're going to need permits and licenses. So if you have the ability to partner or to go under somebody else's license without having to pay for it as a new company, as a startup, that would be great. And then whatever your rules are in terms of for distribution here of product as it comes on board.
Okay.
What is the type of product that you're producing?
There's edibles, also topicals. So topicals and edibles.
In THC, CBD?
CBD right now, and I'd like to do more one-to-one because I feel that is the pure medicine.
But at least with the CBD for now, what's great is that you do have the options of doing an online business,
right,
versus having to be in a licensed type of dispensary. So it's just a different distribution model,
okay,
that you're considering.
All right. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Lee Bendinelli. I'm from St. Augustine, Florida, and I'm trying to get into the industry, and I've been reading just about everything I can, and I've seen that through a lot of different emails and solicitations and whatnot, that there's a lot of different training facilities or academies or colleges, whatever you might call it, for either being a bud tender or certification to work in the MMJ industry. First of all, I'd like to ask, which ones are credible and are they necessary?
That's a great question.
I'm not answering that.
That's okay.
Well, I'll give the first part of this. I absolutely believe there are different degrees of what would be a credible resource for education and getting immersing yourself. This being one of them, the Florida Cannabis Coalition, I think, is a very credible organization to seek out for furthering your education and making and creating connections and aligning yourself with the experts that you need in the various areas as you do your fact finding to find out where you will fit in. But there are some more quote accredited type of education programs. For example, in California, that many people have gone through. I believe Carlos did, in fact, with Oosterdam University, correct? So, I mean, you can seek out more of the ones that have had, you know, have a track record in doing so. Obviously, doing it in your own state is going to have the value of working within your own laws and in the market that's here.
You know, that's a great question.
Not to pitch the Florida Cannabis Coalition, and you know it's their event, but if you're in Florida and you're looking to understand the cannabis industry, this really is the group you want to be involved with. And I think from there, you know, one of the things about a new industry, whether it was the dot-coms back, you know, 15 years ago or it's now, there are a lot of snake oil salesmen out there.
Yes.
There are a huge amount of people who are going to try and take your money and are not providing the services they can. And I think having an organization like this and kind of venting with them and saying, what do you think of them, or there's a several others that are pretty good out there, I think would be my first step if I was going to enter this arena and get their input. And then they can at least guide you where they know maybe those traps aren't.
Now, I might also add that, you know, this is a very new industry, right? So there is no real accredited college program or anything like that. And there's been a moratorium on research. So we're going to be discovering a lot more about the plant, I'm sure, over the next 20 years. But I mean, the idea, you should get as much information as you possibly can, compare your sources, and just kind of reach your own consensus about what is real and what isn't. And really, to add, you know, we're talking about you know, education, but what about consulting as well? You're going to have a lot of consultants out there that, you know, really aren't worth anything. You know, definitely not going to be worth what you're paying them. So there will be some really good consultants out there as well. But you need to be informed before even choosing a consultant. So
yeah,
I just have a follow up. Are certifications required to work in a dispensary?
No,
not yet.
No,
yeah.
No. It's actually a really good question. And if you call our office and you talk to Carlos about membership, you know, one of the things you might hear him say is, we're not offering certifications or badges or stuff like that. And the reason he says that now is because there are a lot of companies that are out there doing that and offering like badges, and they don't really mean it much of anything if they're not coming from, if you're not really getting the you know, the quality education from them. So there's a lot of different certifications. Carlos will tell you when he left the, you know, the place that he went to go study, that he would go to a dispensary and they'd say, okay, great. Where'd you work before? Where's your experience? Like Aaron was saying, it's a very new industry. And you know, if you haven't been, it's hard to have experience in an industry that's been underground, right? So what, you know, that part of it is evolving, and it's gonna be in the next couple of years, probably one of the bigger areas, I feel, is that training and that certification as it comes out more into the light.
Great. Thank you very much.
You got it.
I'd like to thank y'all for your time. My name's Clay Carver. I'm from up in the Panhandle. And I had just one question about what percentage of a business's profit, like a dispensary or grow operation or whatever, would be reasonable to pay out in a security operation for security.
Help me understand the question. Are you looking to know what the cost of security for operations are?
That too. How much folks pay for security?
So how much of your revenue, what percentage of revenue should you be spending on security? Is that the question?
So that's a really broad question. We'll try and stay in Florida. We're involved in 16 states across the United States. You pay more in New York than you do, say, in California. And we'll take Florida and we'll do a mid, like a Pennsylvania would be or something like that. So if you were going to open up a dispensary, your security and your four main securities is alarm, access control, safes, and video. And I'm going to talk about this at 2 o'clock a little bit more in detail. But those are the four main. And then you'll have guards, you'll have armored car services, therefore. So figure a normal size dispensary, which would be about the size of a normal jewelry store, say, you're spending somewhere in the vicinity of $40,000 to $60,000 in overall security. If you're a grow facility, you're spending somewhere between $60,000 and $100,000 for a grow facility, depending on how large your facility. You know, you take rule of thumb. We don't sell any equipment, so we work with vendors. Rule of thumb is for every camera you're going to have, it's $1,000. So you have 30 cameras, your video system is going to cost you about $30,000. That includes everything, wiring, the DVR and all that kind of stuff. So there is some sort of matrix. But gross, you should budget around $100,000, hopefully come in closer to $70,000. And dispensaries, you should budget somewhere around 50,000 and hope to come closer to 30, basically.
And that's yearly, correct?
No, that's the equipment. That's the install of the equipment to open up your facility. That includes your video, your alarms, your access control, and your safes, your barrier security.
Of course, there's ongoing, right?
That is ongoing, whether that's going to be transportation costs that you're going to have to incur, you know, your day-to-day culture of honesty programs that you have out there. But I'm talking about if you're ready to open. And that's really where you're going to have to think about when you do your application. And we'll talk a little bit more about that later.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank y'all.
Thank you.
All right. Well, thanks to our panel, Aaron, Tony, Craig, Jill.